What is going on, people? Today I want to go ahead and talk about how to properly set up your base defense, because I see a lot of people have a lot of just random troops thrown together without any sort of direction, and then they just assume that it's the best that they could do. But today we're going to talk about what exactly you should be looking for and what exactly you should be doing in order to get the best out of your base. Now, going forward, I'm going to assume that you at least know most of the basics, like making sure that you're only focusing on one troop at a time, etc. But if not, I will touch on it at least. So as you can tell, I'm just going to use my base as the example, right? I have my super heavy, which is the troop that I have my pretty much all my components, etc. all on, the one that I focused on the most. Then I have two anti-tank guns. I have a siege, and then I also have my medium. Now, there's a couple of different reasons as to why I chose these as of right now. Now, of course, the one unit that you're training the most, meaning that's the one that you have all of your modifications on, like this one, I have my mouse completely all modded, all done, my parts all gold. So this is pretty much all gone, all done, right? So this is the one troop that is absolutely a must for my base. But then if you are going to be focusing all your components, etc., into one troop, it means that the rest of your other four are somewhat going to be much weaker, because they're not going to have all the extra components, upgrades, and all of that that your one unit has. So what do you do then? Well, if your troops are not going to have a bunch of upgrades, this is one of the reasons why a lot of people go with Siege, because with Siege, they have very low durability, meaning that they get taken out super quick, but they have higher firepower. And since they're mostly going to be on your base, not really being targeted, this is probably the best option for you. Now, the anti-tank gun, this one right here, is one of the favorites to choose from, because it has super high armor penetration. And of course, when you're going base to base, trying to take down bases, etc., what a lot of people like to use is either super heavies or heavies to take to tank most of your base damage. But if you have the anti-tank gun, you can take care of them rather fast. And not only can you use one, you can use two. You can use three even. But if you get three, you probably should upgrade it to the next one. But at the moment, I'm sporting two. I am so close to getting this one up to also two stars, and then that way I can get this one upgraded even better. I can't wait for that. But this is the reason why I'm using two anti-tank guns, because now if a super heavy is trying to tank the hits from my base, they are going to get absolutely melted. Now, the other one that I'm using, the other siege that I'm using, is this one, this the howitzer. And that's because this one also counters infantry. Now, again, you use the same reasoning. It's going to have some of the highest firepower without any sort of investment. So right now it has 535,000 firepower, only 31,000 durability. But look at the modification. It basically has no modifications and it has that kind of firepower. So the biggest threats to your base as far as soaking in your damage is the super heavies and the heavies, which my anti-tank guns will take care of, and then any sort of infantry that might be bunkering, etc., that will also take a hit. Well, but now since I have the howitzer that would counter that, they will also be suffering quite a bit of damage. So we've pretty much made sure that anything that could decently take a hit from us, the super heavies, the infantry, heavies, etc., they're pretty much going to be taking quite a bit of damage some way, somehow. And then my fifth unit that I'm using is this medium. Now, there's a couple of reasons why I'm using this medium. I was actually debating on using this other howitzer for the same reasons that I was using the other one, but there's a couple of things that came into play in as to the reasoning why I'm using this medium tank. For one, it has all gold parts. Some of these don't really matter. For instance, the track and the engine, the suspension, because they're just giving you durability, etc. And if you're gonna be if they're gonna be in your base, that doesn't really matter. But it has the gold gun, and then it also has the coupler lock. So right now, it probably will outperform the other one, because I don't have any gold parts for the other siege unit that I have. So right now, it's probably much better. And then the other reasoning is, if you go over here to your systems and your camp rank, depending on which one you've been training the most with your commanders, your camp rank is actually going to determine the type of bonuses that you get. So for instance, here I've mainly been focusing on Vanguard and Martyr's Watch. So because of that, if you actually take a look at this, with Blitzkrieg, at level 2, I get damage attack plus 9% and damage resist plus 9% when 3 Vanguard Division units are deployed. And again, I have my Super Heavy and my 2 anti-tank guns. That's 3. So right there, I'm getting the 9% damage attack and 9% damage resist. Now, since I have the other Siege and my Medium, then I have 2 of the Martyr's Watch, and that is damage attack plus 3%, damage resist plus 3% when 2 Martyr's Watch units are deployed. So not only am I getting the 9% bonus, I'm getting the 3% bonus from this one as well, which makes it a 12% bonus altogether, which is also one of the main reasons I was using this medium tank, because not only does it have better parts, but it will also give me that that bonus from the camp. There's also a couple of other things that I want to point out in as to why I did the way that I did it here. This one, of course, is my maxed out troop. It has everything, the modifications done, my parts all done, etc. But the other ones, there was a couple of things that I did. Like, for instance, you see here that this one has barely any modifications, but if you take a look at the parts, it has quite a few gold parts. The ones that matter anyway, the ones that are meant for damage. And if you look at the level 100 one, it has silver parts. But if you look at the modifications, it actually has more modifications. Now, you may ask, why exactly would you do it that way? Why wouldn't you just modify the ones that would do the most damage? Well, the way that the camp ranks work now, or the power grades, it's that right now, once you get it to 10,000, you get firepower plus 13,000, and I feel like that is the key one for the most part that is obtainable, because once you get it to 10,000, you get that extra 13,000 firepower, and that is gonna add so much oomph to your attacks. This one, since it's a 120, I was able to take it up all the way to 12,000, meaning that I get that extra penetration depth, which is exactly what it's here for, so it's even better. But if you take a look at this other one, the anti-tank gun that's level 100, it is just over 10,000, but it does get that bonus of 13,000. And the only way that I was able to get it that high is with that extra modifications, because I didn't have the parts to do it. If you take a look at this one, this howitzer, I also have it at 10.1, just enough to get that firepower plus 8,700. And how did I do that? I also gave it enough modifications to reach 10,000. And then, of course, my level 80 is also at 10,000, in large part because of the parts. They're all gold, but I gave it enough modifications as well to get it to just 10,000, which would give it plus 10,000 firepower. So if you add up all the extra firepower that I got just from making sure that they reach 10,000 specifically, you're looking at, let's see, you got 10,000 here. I believe this one was 8,000. So let's just round up and say 19,000. And then from these, you get, from both of these, you get 26,000. So we're talking 40 plus thousand extra firepower just because I made sure that everything got to 10,000 before I started taking everything up. Now, I got them all to that power grade before this was even 120. And then once I got it to 120, I make sure that this got enough to get to the pen depth. And then now I'm going to be working on this one to try and get it to 12,000 as well, because I want the penetration depth on my anti-tank guns to be as high as possible, because that's what they're there for. This ones don't matter too much, because the kill radius, that's not really as big as the penetration depth at that grade. So the one thing, the main thing that I was worried about most is the firepower, which I got. So this one and this one are completely fine. I don't really have to worry about it. If I can get this one to 12,000, great, but it's not a big rush because that's not really what they're here for. And then with all the troops and everything, when it's all said and done, and you have it all set up the way that you wanted, if you are being attacked, make sure that most of your troops actually stay inside of your command center. Because I see a lot of people, when they're getting raided, they like to take out all the troops at once. And that's fine if you know that you're going to be able to get free hits. Now, if they're able to target your siege and take them out, that's going to leave you vulnerable. So a lot of times what you want to do is you want to see, you want to leave your siege or whatever other four units you have alone to be able to do their thing if you do get attacked. But your maxed out unit, or the one that you're trying to max out, is the one that you would actually counter and take out of the base. Try to target the lowest HP units that are attacking you. So for instance, if you have a super heavy that your command center is targeting, but they're also trying to hit you with some siege, then make sure that when you pop out like this, make sure that you're not targeting the super heavy, make sure that you're targeting the siege, because those are the highest priority ones. But yeah, make sure also that you're using this to your advantage to go from place to place. Because you see, I was on the top, now I'm at the bottom, I can go back, and now I'm at the right. So it makes it so much easier to defend when you can just pop in and out of your base and change the location of where your unit is. That is also very, very helpful. But yeah, these are some of the tips that I wanted to share as far as how I make sure that I try to get the best out of my base defense. I know that there is a research tree coming out very soon that might change some of this. So hopefully not, but hopefully you find this helpful. Appreciate you guys for watching, and until later. Bye.